立法會主席。
The President。
喂，早晨。
Good morning. Council will resume on the debate on safeguarding Hong Kong from Mainlandization. Mr. Yip Kin Yuen. President, Mr. Albert Chan, good morning. I'm sure that Mr. Yip will have something very good to share with us, so I would like to ask members to come back. Headcount, please.
이빈
Mr. Kinyon. Mr. President, today's motion is about Hong Kong's core values and culture. Well, when we were young, we've been taught by Facebook that Hong Kong is a Chinese and Western hotspot. We have traditional Chinese tradition, and at the same time, we're very receptive towards Western culture. We are very inclusive, and that is where Hong Kong's success lies. Hong Kong is very closely knitted with the mainland. And exchange of people, exchange of funds. And of course, Hong Kong is affected by the mainland and vice versa, and that is only normal. However, what we are concerned most is not normal exchange, but abnormalities or anomalies. Well, under the basic law, we have 50 years unchanged style of life, and we have one country, two systems. However, in recent years, it seems that one country is imposing itself over two systems, and two systems will be subsumed under the one country. And this is contrary to the basic law. Say, for example, the series of incidents happening at Hong Kong U shows that one of our core values, institutional autonomy, has been threatened. Well, institutional autonomy means that the institution will be independent and free from interference. And it seems that this does not exist in the mainland, and that's been the case for the past 10 years, because institutions are regulated and controlled by the party and the authority. The mainland has their own way of life, and ours are different, and we don't want theirs to be imposed on us. However, government officials have been saying that since they receive government funding, universities should subject themselves to interference or interventions of the government. And this has been eroding two systems, and that's only one example. What I would like to say that exchange is normal. It's important to understand the mainland, but we have to bear in mind that Hong Kong should maintain one country, two system, mutual respect, and we should insist on our core values.
I do believe that being different is conducive to the development of Chinese culture and the Hong Kong in the long run. We also discussed about a number of policies, and I would like to talk about using Putonghua as the medium of exchange. Teaching is a professional discipline, however, in reality, it is affected by politics and the economy. In the secondary school, we've been discussing about using Chinese or English as the medium of teaching. However, for the Chinese subjects, where we are now talking about whether to use Putonghua or Cantonese. Political considerations will give rise to other issues, say, for example, the governance and also social issues. Some people think that you're using Putonghua to teach Chinese will help the children to secure employment and to give them better opportunities in the future. But when it comes to teaching, you have to respect the professions and their judgment. By that, I mean which medium is the most effective and best for students. Let me clarify that using Putonghua to teach Chinese is not just about using Cantonese or Putonghua. We're talking about two different formulation of curriculum. Using Putonghua, it means that there won't be any Putonghua lessons, and Putonghua will be used to teach Chinese language. Using Cantonese to teach Chinese language is to have the Chinese subject and Putonghua lessons, Putonghua subject. Cantonese will be used to teach Chinese subject, and Putonghua will be used to teach Putonghua subject. They will go in tandem. So no matter what the strategy is, whether it is Putonghua or Cantonese, the goal is the same. That is to attach equal importance on the bilingualism and biliteracy and trilingualism, the learning of Cantonese, that is Chinese, and or Chinese subject and Putonghua. Some people think that, well, if you have more time spent using Putonghua, then your proficiency will increase. And Putonghua is close to written Chinese, and it will help with your ability to write. And these are what the advocates say. But they don't stand if you look further into it. Hong Kong has a very unique language environment. And a number of academic studies, say, for example, Leung Pui Wan, Che Sek Kam, in their studies, it shows that using Putonghua to teach Chinese subject will give rise to a volume of difficulties. I say, for example, where at a tender age, it's very important to arouse their interest. So lively language will get the attention of young children. But if you use a strange language to teach and learn the Chinese language, then it will deter them from learning, and it also undermines the ability of students to express logic and complicated feelings. Using Putonghua to teach will restrict the breadth and depth of thinking of a lot of students. Well, some people say that using Cantonese to teach is learning Cantonese. Well, actually, using Cantonese, they will learn about Chinese language, and use Putonghua. Then they will learn using Putonghua to write. And this, in reality, will be more suited to the majority of students in Hong Kong. And we have a lot of excellent Chinese writers, and they are trained this way. So when it comes to effectiveness, well, has it been any improvement using Putonghua to teach Chinese? No. Their confidence suffers, and the proficiency suffers as well. So to set aside using Putonghua to teach Chinese is justified. For a lot of students, using Cantonese to teach Chinese and a separate Putonghua subject is better. Of course, some schools should be allowed to continue to use Putonghua.
Mr. Tong Yizhe. Thank you, President. President, I speak to oppose the motion as well as the amendment. In recent years, the more and more we hear this term mainlandization. A small bunch of so-called opposition members from the opposition camp and localists use mainlandization as an excuse to look down on the mainland or China, they think that anything made or produced on the mainland are inferior, and even Chinese are inferior, and therefore they are very resistant towards anything Chinese. I think this is entirely wrong and dangerous. What is meant by mainlandization? I've tried to search for an answer. Still, I cannot find a definition for mainlandization. From a political point of view, I think it is purely an ideology. Nowadays, there are a small group of people who have attached very negative feelings to the term mainlandization. They think that mainlandization means that our local culture and our social environment and also our economy will be eroded, and therefore they are strongly against mainlandization. President, I have no intention to judge or comment whether mainlandization is something good or bad, but I want to discuss how we should look at this thing, mainlandization. And I'm worried that if the community is too negative about mainlandization, then there will be more and more people who are radicals, and in the long term, this is going to pose a lot of danger to Hong Kong. We must not allow our success to be undermined by a small group of people and thinking that is wrong, distorted, and misleading. And I think this is not something most people would like to see. Some commentators have written articles on the printed media concluding our experience in the past decade or so of reunification. They say that there are four dangers. First, mainlandization in terms of their ideology. They used examples such as national education and the avocation of patriotism. I failed to see how the how national education in schools would be linked with mainlandization, leading Hong Kong into a crisis. In fact, Hong Kong is part of China, and we have reunited with China for almost 20 years. National education in schools will allow young people to understand China more, so as to develop a sense of identity with China. What's wrong with that? How come you call that a crisis? Of course, when you learn about China, you don't just learn about the good side. You also need to learn areas where improvement is needed. In fact, the Central People's Government have introduced a number of changes and improvements. As Chinese, we should give them our support so that the country can continue to progress. So I'm against such sentiments of anti-mainlandization. I don't want such sentiments to continue to harm Hong Kong. And I'm also strongly against all the amendments, because the content is unrealistic and is a departure from the real development needs of Hong Kong. For instance, the proposal to abolish multi-entry individual visit endorsements for Shenzhen residents and to shelve the adaptation of using Putonghua to teach Chinese language subject as the long-term teaching goal. In fact, the latter can help our young people to lay a firm foundation in their Putonghua proficiency. This will help their competitiveness in their future career. Regarding the multiple entry individual visit endorsements, I think the problem is we don't have sufficient resources. and supporting capacity. So we urge the administration to review all the relevant measures and enhance resources for better coordination and support so that the relevant measure can benefit our transportation industries, our hospitality and our retail industries, so that all sectors can benefit. President, I don't want this ideology of anti-mainlandization continue to erode our society, affecting our future and development. Furthermore, I don't want to see people continuing to look down or belittle Chinese and China. With these remarks, I oppose the motion and the amendments. Mr. Vincent Fang. Good morning, President. The motion urges the government to respect the local history and culture and to safeguard Hong Kong from mainlandization so as to honor the undertaking in the basic law that the previous way of life of Hong Kong residents shall remain unchanged for 50 years. I find this baffling. If we are to maintain the previous way of life of Hong Kong residents unchanged for 50 years, why should we only guard against mainlandization? What about influence from Japanese, Korean cultures? Shouldn't we safeguard Hong Kong people from such influences? Should we ensure that we will not be affected by Japanese or Korean culture as well? So I think the motion is very discriminatory against the mainland, and it's also distorted the meaning of respecting the local culture and history, and I find it acceptable. Mainlandization, this term, has been hijacked by radical localists, and I think it is now denatured. Whenever we use the term mainlandization, the following scene would come to our mind. We would see a bunch of very violent and rowdy localists besieging visitors to scold them or to check their luggage, and they may also crowd our retail outlets so that these people cannot do business. And I think this started with babies born of non-permanent residents of Hong Kong. And then when increasingly have the problems of peril traders, the problem has escalated. They have various campaigns to drive the so-called locusts away. They are getting more and more radical. Even local residents have been subject to harassment. I think what they do is going to harm and kill Hong Kong. I've told the government a number of times that something has to be done immediately. For instance, to explain to the mainland that such behavior only represents a small group of rude and residents in Hong Kong. Most people in Hong Kong are friendly and welcome visitors to come to Hong Kong from all over the world. Unfortunately, the government hasn't done a good job in this regard. In particular, the CE, Siwai Leung, has not grasped the opportunity to explain to mainland visitors. As a result, they only receive negative information or messages about Hong Kong. I hope Siwai Leung understands that such rude behavior is not just reported in Hong Kong, but also on the mainland. The scenes of localists pushing and shoving mainland visitors are broadcast all over the world and on the mainland in particular. So people have the misconception that Hong Kong is no longer a city of hospitality. Last Friday, the government announced the economic report for the third quarter, and then we understand how bad the situation is. The overall visitors to Hong Kong dropped by 6.4% in the third quarter, and that's the first time since the third quarter of 2003. And 79% of the And visitors from the mainland dropped by 7.3%, and the total retail turnover dropped by 6.4% on a year month-on-month basis, and is already dropping for 7 months in a row. And the total amount of commodities sold also dropped by 3.1%. So these are negative figures. If we cannot resolve the negative sentiments, I'm afraid our retail business turnover will continue to drop at Christmas and New Year, and some smaller retail outlets may have to close down, and this will negatively affect our labor market. In the long term, Hong Kong will be beyond savage. So, first things first, we must unite and do our very best to rebuild our image of hospitality. First, the government should not just turn a blind eye to the situation and must try to resolve the conflicts between the two places, ASAP, and for all radicals, you must step up enforcement against any illegal behavior. And most important of all, legislators here should not add fuel to fire. And please do not reignite the discussion on anti-parallel goods traders and also the campaign of localists. I don't know whether it is because of the district council elections, which is just a few days away, and as a result, people want to start up this debate so as to campaign for the candidates. However, in so doing, we are doing a disservice to Hong Kong. I hope the member who moves amendments to this motion can reflect on himself. I cannot accept this motion, which is discriminatory, and therefore I oppose the original motion as well as the amendments. Thank you, President.
Mr. Ma Fung Kwok, Mr. President, Ms. Claudia Mo moves a motion to respect local history and culture and safeguard Hong Kong from mainlandization. I cannot identify with it. Hong Kong is a diversified and accommodating society. If you emphasize localism, if you are trying to strengthen a sense of belonging and to get to know the history of Hong Kong, well, that is not debatable. But I will not subscribe to any form of developing a sense of separatism in Hong Kong, that we are going to harbor hatred towards China. Ms. Mo is asking for demilitarization. I really can't subscribe to it. The mainland, the word mainland, would mean Chinese mainland. It is not about geography, but politics. But talking about geography, Hong Kong is always part of China. In 1842, it was conceded to the British, and there was colonial rule in Hong Kong. But then Hong Kong people and Chinese people could still go to each other's territories. And it was only 66 years ago that during the Second World War, there was also a war of between KMT and CCP, and then the gates were closed. But then during the British rule, Shenzhen River was used as a border, and there is a restricted zone between Hong Kong and China, and there are immigration controls. And then after decades, the Chinese mainland is now being called the PRC. Somehow the two are identical. But now, because of more exchanges between the mainland and Hong Kong, the media are calling China mainland. Now, if we still call the country mainland, I think it amounts to an ideological difference. There are people in Hong Kong who refuse to accept the fact that our sovereignty has been returned to China, and they refuse to accept one country, two systems, and also the basic law that was promulgated in 1990. The only some Southeast Asian countries and Taiwan don't call call China mainland. Not many other people do it. Today, you call for demilitarization. I can grant you the best of intentions, but I would still think that you are very backward in your thinking. You are still very colonial in your mindset. Last month, during the CE's Q&A session, Ms. Claudia Mo already talked about demilitarization, the tough measures to stem speculation in the property market, and also the two-tin rule about baby formula. Ms. Claudia Mo distorted the facts and called those measures a way to please China. But Hong Kong is part of China. Hong Kong has one country, two systems, and we leverage on the advantages of having the mainland as our hinterland. We are envied by the world. China is rising fast, and people are flocking to China in order to take advantage of the rising economy there. Hong Kong and our motherland are closely related. Most of us are Chinese, and China has a long history. In Hong Kong, we have the West meeting the East, and we enjoy the merits of the different cultures. And we are so much related to China. Think about Dongjiang water. Think about the cereals, the meat that we consume. They all come from China, and we also use a lot of daily necessities, and our clothing are made in China. With the development of the economy, our cultures are just going to merge even more, and no one can stop the process. Those who are calling for the mainlandization should be rational. Think about what we are doing here in Hong Kong today. Because if you live in Hong Kong and work in Hong Kong, you definitely cannot seek to sever ties with the mainland. Mr. Gary Fan is really asking for severing all ties with China. I remember, again, in one of the CE's question and answer session, Mr. Gary Fan actually staged some theatrics. He was pulling a suitcase, inappropriately, of course, in this council, and also he was involved in certain acts against mainland tourists. Mr. President, our society is becoming more politicized. Localism or nativism resists integration with the mainland. On Tuesday night, we have this World Cup qualifying group game, and some people also took the opportunity to cause trouble in order to radicalize the match. There were people distributing protest slogans outside the stadium, and they were waving the British colonial flag, and also they hurled foul language against mainland players inside the stadium. But We should be polite to mainlanders. That is basic decency. The two teams should respect each other, and Hong Kong is part of China. Some soccer fans refused to listen to warnings, and they booed the national anthem. In fact, they have flouted the international soccer game rules. This is behavior that shows that we do not have enough civic education in Hong Kong. It has also brought shame onto Hong Kong. With these remarks, I object to the original motion and also the amendment motion. Mr. Ng Leung Sing, thank you, President. What is Hong Kong's local history? From time prehistoric, Hong Kong is part of China geographically. But Hong Kong was snatched from China by guns and gunboats. And who could take back Hong Kong? It is because our country has become strong, so now we are reunited with the motherland. Hong Kong has a convoluted way to negotiate before we could go back to our motherland. And young children who have studied history would know this. What is Hong Kong's local culture? Hong Kong is a society made up mainly by Chinese. And Chinese culture, which has a stretch of thousands of years, especially that of
South China has great influence in Hong Kong. Of course, we have gone through over a centuries of British rule. So in Hong Kong, the East meets the West. Hong Kong is also an international metropolis, and as mentioned by members, we're also influenced by Japanese, Indian, Thai, and Korean cultures. So we are unique when you talk about Hong Kong culture. And also, in terms of other kinds of culture, we also have Chinese medicine, we have local catering, we have our own songs, we also have herbal tea, incense stick dragons, we have the Ping Chow, or actually Cheng Chow parade, float parade. A lot of these have been included. The non-tangible culture heritage of China. Ms. Mo has said that the government should be urged to respect local history and culture. And then one cannot but ask, who has not respected local history and culture ever since the reunification? The motion itself shows that, in effect, it is just talking about anti-mainlandization. Well, you have the African mainland and other continents, but when it comes to mainlandization, even if it's not said here, it is targeting the Chinese mainland. Demainlandization amounts to de-sinalization. You are trying to negate the country that you belong to. This is very dangerous. So you can't blame the people for saying that so-called mainlandization is irrational. The so-called localists or nativists are exaggerating conflicts that naturally arise when there are exchanges, say for example one-way permits and parallel goods trading. Of course, social issues have resulted from these, but they are exaggerating them. They are also boycotting integration between Hong Kong and the mainland, and in the end, they are just trying to separate from the country, and in the end, they are going to harm the two systems. This is very worrying. Hong Kong might eventually become an independent political entity. This shows a lot of political ambition. Mr. President, we are born here, we grow here, we, of course, love our land. But we are a special administrative region, after all. We must carry on our development with the entire population on the mainland. That is only natural. Now, we have the basic law to show us how Hong Kong will be governed, and that will, to the largest extent, safeguard Hong Kong's local interests. Article 5 states that the socialist system and policies shall not be practiced in the Hong Kong Special Administrative Region, and the previous capitalist system and way of life shall remain unchanged for 50 years. Ever since reunification, mainland systems have not been imposed on Hong Kong. This is a fact that cannot be denied. Some extremists make use of localism to continue to engage in separatist acts. We must stay alert to these and must stop them in good time so Hong Kong people and the country will not be harmed. We must protect Hong Kong's fundamental interests. With these remarks, I object to the original motion and the amendment motion.
Does anyone else want to speak? I need a head count.
那么议员要发言。
Does any member wish to speak? Mr. Lam Kwok Hong, I would like to speak. Good morning, Mr. President. About, opposing to Mainlandization, according to Mr. Ng Lui Seng, is the decolonization. Well, I think it actually means the Chinese Communist Party. Well, a lot of members have spoken a lot about what happened recently. I think it's about Hong Kong being turned more and more like communist China, which means that people will be subservient towards the party, the party will be subservient to the central political committee, and then all the way up, in the end, everything will be subservient towards President Xi. And that is simple. In the past, before the CPC, the Chinese, the Communist Chinese Communist Party, Communist China, could consolidate its power, they did not want to make any careless move because they needed to consolidate their power first. So they had to move very carefully. The group of interests represented by CY Leung is the capitalist, the mainland capitalist group wants to profiteer in Hong Kong. Well, that was measures to curb and to cool down the property market. Well, a lot of people, they might speculate property on the mainland, but nothing is done. But now CY Leung wanted to punish those who speculate on property. But now you see that a lot of people are trying to buy land, especially land that is close to the border, Hung Shui Kiu and NT North, so that they will have a more bargaining chip to manipulate the property market. And now there is the third runway. It's a way to kill yourself. And they try to let mainland capital buying up our properties and buying up our companies. Well, someone, just a few people buying up all our land, and they just squeeze everything out of the land and leave us with some unusable land, then we will be in trouble. Hong Kong is open for everyone to come here to take. But of course, if you are supported by some mainland conglomerate, of course you are in their pocket, and they will make sure that you work for them. And CY Leung talked about those with an income of 14,000. And they are the majority of Hong Kong people. We want equality. I think the target is wrong. Hong Kong has a capitalist system, but now it's turned into one with Chinese characteristics. And those mainland conglomerates will actually manipulate Hong Kong. And CY Leung has demonstrated to us another mainlandization, which is to be a toady. And I think the director of protocol will lose his job soon, because CY Leung is going to take up that duty. He said when he was in the Philippines that he would go and receive President Xi in the Philippines. And he repeatedly quoted what Xi Jinping said when it's not allowed. And one time he could very well twisted what President Xi Jinping said. Perhaps President Xi said that, well, you haven't done really well when it comes to the constitutional reform. You will have to do better. And then Xi Wailong said, Xi Jinping said that he is doing better. Well, there is a conference in Moscow. And someone said that, well, there is a sun outside, there is also a sun inside the aircraft, meaning Mao Zedong. And it's really corny. And Xi Wailong was asked, well, actually, where are you staying? Then they... He doesn't even know who you are. And when someone is powerful riding a horse and you try to toady up by picking up the horse dropping after him. Of course, well, when a former official, when Zhuang Zhang went along with the delegation, of course, the mainland officials know where Zhuang Zhang is staying. But now, well, Xi Wailong is trying to resort to rhetorics. The country is trying to do something important, and he's making trouble. And someone was talking about a color revolution, but Xi Wailong was talking about color revolution, but he could not come up with some evidence. What if Xi Jinping said, "Can you give me some evidence?" You don't call this Mainlandization, you don't call this sycophant. The problem with a gang of four is to toady up to Mao Zedong. And today the same is done to Xi Jinping. But don't use Hong Kong's dignity as shoe polish. We have never asked you to toady up to Xi Jinping. You want to die, don't drag us with you. Does any other member wish to speak? Mr. Ray Chen. Thank you, President. I speak in support of Ms. Mo's motion. Well, we may have very different understandings on this motion. My understanding of the motion is to protect Hong Kong's value and culture and to resist the inferior and poor value of the and culture of the mainland. For every place during different times, they have good culture, they have bad culture. When we're saying that we want to protect Hong Kong's good culture, it doesn't mean that we don't have any shortcomings. And when I say we resist the poor culture of the mainland, but I did not say that there is nothing good about China culture. I know that we have opera, kung fu, architecture, and a lot more, and calligraphy. But China itself does not know how to preserve its good heritage. And if you want to look for ancient Chinese culture, you have to go to Japan. Say, the architecture of the Tang Dynasty, you have to go to Japan. Recently, I saw something. It's an ancient pipa of the Tang Dynasty. It's found in Japan because everything is destroyed in China. There is cultural exchange, and through cultural exchange, different places affect one another. And stronger culture will assimilate weaker cultures, and that is only natural. Mrs. Virginia Ip talked about cultural conflict. Actually, power affects cultural exchange as well. And of course, a strong culture or a strong power will affect your neighboring places. Say, for example, those non-ethnic and Chinese race, they will be assimilated, and we also talk about westernization. We learn from places where there are merits. You're always subject to cultural exchange and impact of different cultures. What you need to pay attention and when to interfere is a time when you realize that your good culture is being eroded and damaged or perhaps destroyed by something that is inferior. You will have to put in place measures to make sure that that doesn't happen. Say, for example, in Hong Kong, well, we have higher hygiene standard. We have queues. We won't poo and wee in the street, and we will queue up. But when it comes to mainland behavior, that is, they just use streets as toilets, they don't queue up, and it affects Hong Kong people, it erodes our culture, then the government will have to be mindful and do something. They are doing it. There are publicity campaigns telling mainland visitors to respect our order, respect our culture. Yesterday, a lot of legislators frame Claudia Mo. Well, my interpretation about resisting China, it doesn't mean that we object whenever it's something to do with China and we advocate independence of Hong Kong. It doesn't mean that. It's not an equivalent. It's a leap of many, many times before you reach that conclusion. And when Ms. Mo talked about resisting Chinese culture, we're talking about making fake goods, corruption, abuse of power. I did not hear yesterday that the members talk about these three things. And they have an imaginary opponent dressed as Ms. Mo. And I said that, well, you just want to destroy this this dummy dressed as Ms. Mo, saying that you advocate independence of Hong Kong and you resist everything that is Chinese. A lot of people are nostalgic. They think about the good old days. And that is true. It's not a Roman Tam, Lydia, Shum, and Bruce Lee. Indeed, these are glorious days that happened during the colonial days. It's been 18 years after reunification. Well, we don't have anything else that we can talk about that we're proud of. Not unlike before the reunification. In CY Leung's first policy address, paragraph 179, he says, in culture and heritage, said in the past decade, we have famous Hong Kong magazines, songs, and it has taken overseas Chinese have been completely taken. And that's his words. And if you say that, well, Hong Kong people are always thinking about the good old days, then you, as the government, will have to reflect on yourself as to what happened. Is it because, well, the past days were too glorious for us to, for you to surpass? Or is it that we are really doing very poorly? Well, like Wang Guangya, he said that his grandchildren will have to rely on Hong Kong formula milk. But if Hong Kong's food safety system has turned mainlandized, then it's not good for us. Neither is it good for mainland people. My cat, I have been using cat food manufactured in Europe. And my supplier told me that now the manufacturing is done in Shanghai, so you have to think again. So it's about confidence. We are very concerned whether the meat you're eating is actually rat meat or just cardboard. You were talking about confidence and also a brand of quality that we have in Hong Kong. I talk about just sub-quality food or fake food on the mainland. If we learn this kind of things from the mainland, I was only talking about food, but there is also the political level and also executive working with judiciary. Well, you have to talk about this. I so submit.
The Senate member wish to speak. Dr. An Cheng. Thank you, President. Ms. Claudia Mo's motion is to safeguard Hong Kong from mainlandization. Well, we may ask, how come safeguard Hong Kong from mainlandization. And why doesn't she specify as mainland China? Why is it not the African mainland and the continent? Well, now she's talking about China. And Ms. Mo is not talking about these signification, but the mainlandization. Perhaps Ms. Mo has seen some incidents involving people from the mainland and some uncivilized behavior incidents, and perhaps that's the reason why she's moved this motion, given that China is such a big country, there are bound to be good sides and the bad side. And I think the same applies to people on the mainland. When they see corrupt practices and uncivilized behavior in their own country, they are also unhappy. You see that netizens on the mainland are rather fair. So you don't really have to talk about the mainlandization because of a few issues. You can talk about safeguarding Hong Kong from uncivilized culture from the mainland. I would support that if you say this. And Ms. Mo said that all she wants is the mainlandization and not the signification. On the 26th of September, in response to the remarks by Mr. Chen Zhuo'er, Ms. Mo said that we have to establish our homes first before we can have our country. Now, we of course have our homes. We all have our own home. But what we lack is our country. I didn't know that, but when I grew up, I had the opportunity to study and visit overseas. I went to another country, and when I went through immigration, I wrote down British on the column, nationality. The word British was scrapped, and instead, he wrote Hong Kong Chinese, and at that moment, I understood that I was not British. And was I Chinese? No. There was nothing to prove that I was Chinese, with the exception that I have a yellow skin, black hair and black eyes. My appearance looks Chinese, but there is nothing to prove that I am Chinese. So all along, we had our home, but not our country. And the moment changed in 1997, when we applied for an SAR passport. I'm sure, Ms. Mo, you have one, and that is to prove that we are Chinese. I think we ourselves are happy, and so are our elders, because they have lived for decades in Hong Kong, but they didn't have any passport. What they had was a CI, Certificate of Identity. Earlier on, it was just a sheet of paper. There was no passport, no consular protection. So after 1997, we were reunited with our motherland, and finally, we have our own country, and that explains why people are so joyful. When I went to Canada, Ontario, I went to the consulate there to borrow some Chinese artifacts for exhibition, because we were organizing a cultural week. And that was the first time I came into contact with my motherland, the consulate of Ontario, Canada. And I was so moved, because finally I had the chance to be in contact with my motherland. Well, time is so short in this debate. I really want to sit down and have a good talk with Ms. Claudia Mo. As for the question of the colonization, we still have street names such as Queen's Road Central, Endeavour Road Central. Well, many unfairness have not been righted. Do you know where the BOC headquarters is? Do you know what's the address? The address is Endeavour Road Central, 2A Endeavour Road Central. Why is it 2A? Is that number 2? No. When there are two stores adjacent to one another, we have numbers A and B to make a distinction. But why is BOC headquarters still addressed at number 2A? It is on 2A Denver Road. But in fact, do you know? And of course, there are still a lot of addresses not yet rightly represented, waiting to be rectified. And to be fair, there are people wedging the colonial flags and also people attacking the apparel goods trader. People may think that these are linked to you. Well, to be fair to you, I don't think you are the leader of all these activities. Yes, you have dragged suitcases to protest against the influx of apparel goods traders and also individual visitors. Well, to be fair, we should not make such a sweeping statements. Does any other member wish to speak? Mr. Wong Kwok Hing. President, I speak to oppose Ms. Claudia Mo's original motion and Mr. Gary Fan's amendment because both motions may not contain the term may not mention independence of Hong Kong, but in fact that is the spirit behind the motion amendments. So this is very low and base, and I think it is entirely politically incorrect to talk about the mainlandization and the sinification. I think it is the one of the core values and core thinking of independence for Hong Kong. Hong Kong as long has been an inseparable part of China. To deal with this legacy of history, the government or the country used the Joint Declaration and the Basic Law to ensure that Hong Kong can have one country, two systems, and maintain capitalism and the way of life of Hong Kong to be unchanged for 50 years. Without a strong country, there will be no Basic Law, no one country, two systems, and no Hong Kong SAR. I think this is a correct political narrative. Since ancient times, we have been a part of China. We have the same ethnic origin. The indigenous villagers in Hong Kong are members of the Chinese race. It's just that at different times and different ages, they moved to Hong Kong people, to Hong Kong, but the origin was from the mainland. My father's an overseas Chinese. I was born in Vietnam, and to fled from war, I moved to Hong Kong. My origin was Guangxi, and my ancestor lived in Fujian, Zhangzhou. We are all descendants of Chinese people, and I'd like to ask Ms. Mo, how can we de-mainlandize? We Hong Kong people have roots and origins from the mainland. We cannot deny the sense of identity. We cannot deny the fact that we are from the Chinese race. So I think Ms. Mo's motion seeks to split the nation, tries to divide peoples, and she is trying to create conflicts and contradictions between Hong Kong and mainland people. She is being racial discriminatory, and I think her motivation is very low and despicable. I will not criticize people easily, but I must criticize her motion here. Her intention is despicable. So, when you talk about the mainlandization, you are trying to cut yourself from history and distort history. You have denied the development of Hong Kong. We cannot continue to develop without China as our hinterland. When we come to think of it, the water we drink, the food produce we consume every day, and the raw materials we use, a lot of them come from mainland China. Our business, our livelihood, and also our employment. How can we separate ourselves from the mainland? Even Lee Kuan Yew envied Hong Kong because of a very advantageous position with China as our hinterland. When we have major natural disasters or serious epidemics, or when we were in economic difficulties, our motherland very often supported us without asking for any return of this favor. And these are historical facts that cannot be denied and distorted. The so-called de-sinification and safeguarding Hong Kong from mainlandization is all about things that even the imperial British and the US dare not say. They say that we must not turn mainlandized. They use the excuse of anti-corruption. But I'd like to ask the opposition camp, for 3 years in a row, once again, I like to display this. For 3 years in a row, you have received $40.8 million. The Civic Party, the Democratic Party, and also the Labour Party, and also the LSD, aren't you receiving corrupt money from other forces? So far, you have not give us a clear account of all these incidents. I urge the ICAC to investigate into these cases to let the public know the truth. So you talked about anti-corruption. What about yourselves? What about yourselves? Are you displaying exemplary behavior? Claudia Mo said that she had not received any of this money, but what about her husband? You must come clean. So you have received, on 26 accounts, you have received $40.8 million for 3 years in a row. You have yet to give a clear account to the public. So you talked about anti-corruption here. You talked about corrupt practices on the mainland as legislators, as political parties in Hong Kong. You are not an example for the community. Claudia Mo, I see you have a few minutes left, so please respond to these issues comprehensively. Do not pull wool over the eyes of Hong Kong people. Thank you.
有没有其他议员要发言?
Does any other member wish to speak? Ms. Claudia Mo, you can speak on the amendment moved by Mr. Gary Fan. You have 5 minutes. Thank you, President. In this council, if you want to get something done, you need a lot of humor. First of all, I'd like to thank Mr. Lam Kwok Hong and Mr. Raymond Chan for their supportive speeches. They are excellent speeches. I also thank Ms. Anne Chang. Basically, She subscribes to my proposal that first we have our family, then we have our country. Even though I don't really understand why she spends so much time on the address of the Bank of China. You should use these 5 minutes to speak on the amendment. I understand, Mr. President. With regard to the 4 points moved by Mr. Gary Fan, of course, I agree with all of those. But when members spoke, even the official, when they mentioned these 4 points, they were quite out of control. For example, I said mainlandization. I already said that it would mean corruption and fakes. But then Mr. Lau Kong Wah only talked about the special kind of Chinese milk tea we have in Hong Kong. But the most ridiculous speech came from Mrs. Regina Ip. I think she really warms to the throne of the CE. Now, this is the time for you to speak on the amendment. Yes, I understand. Mr. Gary Fan mentioned that we should have a separate language policy for Cantonese and we should not seek to teach Chinese in Putonghua. But Mrs. Regina Ip said we should not discriminate against Putonghua. My Putonghua is by any measure better than that of Regina Ip. And my Putonghua may well be better than all the pro-establishment camp members. I have got a certificate from the National Putonghua Test. Mrs. Regina Ip, when she spoke, she said we are anti-mainland. And she mentioned the 4 points of Gary Fan. She said, or portrayed us as youth leaders. That is really more like a joke. And the ilk of Mr. Ip Kwok Him, when they mentioned the 4 amendment points, they were just rehashing points given to them by their party. You had no individual insight. And strangely enough, Mr. Ibrahim Shek, Dr. Vincent Fang, who are from the business sector, they are illogical in what they said. They said your demilitarization motion and amendments. Well, this is really strange. Hearing it from Mr. Ibrahim Shek, he never talked like that. He said, what would happen in the Chinatown of overseas countries? Mr. Claudia Mo, are you talking to the amendment motion? Well, yes, I am commenting on the contents of the 4 points in Gary Fan's amendment motion. They also said some agreements or treaties have been signed between Beijing and other countries. They ask whether that would amount to mainlandization of other countries. This is so strange coming from a businessman. It was Dr. Vincent Fang and maybe also Mr. Ibrahim Shek. Sorry, I mistook Mr. Ip Kwok Him for Ibrahim Shek. Agreements are signed by the two signatories. They represent the agreement of the two signatories. So what was said is illogical. But then in Hong Kong, it seems China is exploiting all political measures and tactics, including asking Hong Kong to teach Chinese in Putonghua so that Hong Kong will become just another Chinese city under the control of the mainland, of Beijing. Beijing is coming into Hong Kong like an overlord. But then none of the pro-establishment camp dared debate the corruption situation on the mainland. Thank you.
Secretary for Home Affairs. Mr. President, over the past 2 days, our members have made some suggestions on this motion, and I'd like to reply to them. Some members have talked about preservation of Hong Kong's heritage. As I said in my opening remark, we attach a lot of importance on the protection of intangible cultural heritage. In the 2015 policy address, the government has already said that our efforts in this regard will be strengthened. There will be funds created, studies done, preservations, promotions, efforts put in.
In this regard, at the same time, there is an office set up under the LCSD to deal with an intangible heritage. And there are plans to set up a resource center in Samtonghok, in Chun Wan, the museum, and also regular exhibitions. And the government is at the moment looking into the inventory of intangible cultural heritage to compile the first Hong Kong list of intangible cultural heritage. Well, with the strong efforts to promote protection of intangible cultural heritage, well, the society as a whole know more about intangible heritage these days, and they are getting more and more interested. In recent years, there are some festivities and activities that are that belong to our culture. Say, for example, the Fire Dragon Dance, and also the Bun Festival in Changqiao, and it has attracted a lot of locals and visitors to participate. We've also set up funds to support the preservation and promotion of Hong Kong's traditional culture. Well, we will fund events and activities to protect our cultural culture. We have our roots in Chinese culture, but at the same time, we are affected by Western culture. We will continue to preserve our variety in culture. We are very, Hong Kong people are very inclusive. We have our eyes on the modern world and in other places of the world, and we have our heart in cultural traditional culture. Overseas culture impact on us, and it has enriched our own culture. There are more and more local artists showcasing their excellent pieces. They have got recognition. They have been exhibited overseas. Say, for example, in March this year, the Hong Kong Dance Company staged a performance in New York, and in September, another one in Sydney, and that is Mulan. It has used classical dance with modern music. Adding to that was multimedia to enrich this well-known legend. The story has been told to overseas audience. And there are some other art groups that are invited all the time to perform overseas. Say, for example, in August 2015, the Hong Kong Chinese Orchestra performed in the Baltic Sea, and also participated in the Helsinki Art Festival in Finland. The City Contemporary Dance Company also got an invitation in August 2015 to perform in Niigata in Japan. So our art creation actually are very appealing to overseas audience. We will continue to endeavor to promote our work in this regard. Currently, the government has, together with 15 countries and 5 Chinese provincial and municipalities, signed memoranda of understanding. Through this, we have put in place expressively our wish to put in place cultural exchange. This has laid a very good foundation of our work in the future. We have to protect and the most precious part of our traditional culture. We will keep an open mind to receive different cultures to enrich our lives, so that we can continue to develop our special culture. We will continue to put in resources to promote protection and promotion and passing on of our history and culture, and at the same time create a conducive environment to ensure that art and culture will continue to develop. And if you use
blinkered vision to see the role of Hong Kong, or if you resist different cultures, it's not good for Hong Kong, and it's not something we would like to see, and it's not the Hong Kong we know. There are lots of things that that is worth our appreciation. We should appreciate that Hong Kong has is a cultural hodgepodge, and we should appreciate that Hong Kong is very inclusive. And I'll put a question to you, and that is that the amendment moved by Mr. Gary Fan to Ms. Mo's motion be passed. Will those in favor please raise their hands? Mr. Fan claims the division bell will be run for 5 minutes.
開始表決。
Please proceed to vote. Please verify your votes. If there are no questions, voting is closed, and the results are displayed. Results from FCs 26 present, 4 for, 20 against, 2 abstentions. From GCs 27 present, 9 for, 14 against, 3 abstentions. The question is not agreed by majority respectively of each of the two groups of members present. I declare the amendment negatived. Mr. Andrew Leung, I move that if we will have further divisions with regard to the mainlandization motion, the Council shall proceed forthwith to the division after the bell has been rung for 1 minute. I now propose the question to you, and that is that the motion moved by Mr. Andrew Leung be passed. Those against? The motion is approved by a majority of respectively of each of the two groups of members present. The motion is carried. I order that if there are further divisions on the motion on mainlandization, the Council will proceed to vote after the bell has been rung for 1 minute. Ms. Claudia Mo, now you may reply, and you have 3 minutes 35 seconds.
It's most absurd of that joker, Wong Kwok Heng, to claim that we're conducting racial discrimination against mainlanders. Mainlanders are Chinese compatriots, according to them, at least. Of different race, what's he talking about? And it's such a pity, too, that he wouldn't dare to talk about their receiving renminbi from Beijing, whatever his party is, pro-Beijing, of course. Mainlandization. I first learned this term in Chinese from Sito Wah, one of Hong Kong's grand icons of our democracy fight. And then my impression is that it got picked up in English by the South China Morning Post here, and then further picked up by international labels like The Economist magazine back in 2012. It's internationally known, a term. Now, what's mainlandization? I've already made it clear in Chinese. All about fakeness, rampant, bracket, corruption, abuse of power. It's again such a pity, but not surprising, that none of those political easy riders over there would dare to address the three particular components of mainlandization. On a fakeness front, consumer confidence on the mainland has completely collapsed. Why? Because everything could be fake on the mainland, from fake baby formula to a Ferrari, a fake one. So that brought about our grey goods trader problem. And they're not traders, come on. They are smugglers. And the CY Leung regime would just pretend that, oh, it's a tourism problem. And don't you, again, have any bias against our mainland travellers? Just note the hypocrisy involved. And on the graft front, look at what's been happening to, never mind Rafai Hui, he might be from the colonial era more so, but Donald Zhang, and even CY Leung, he and his receipt of £4 million from UGL. An abuse of power? It's obvious. Ask any right-minded Hong Konger and he can give you a long list of examples. Just look at the Hong Kong University saga and you have a lot to say about it. Throughout this entire debate, that miserable official there would keep talking about, oh, Hong Kong's milk tea or silk stocking milk tea, whatever, if those who are not Chinese-speaking Hong Kongers would understand. Silk stocking milk tea. And clownish figures like Regina Yip will tell us not to discriminate against Putonghua. I speak Putonghua better than Regina Yip. Thank you.
Order, please.
王晶英，你发言时间到了。
Miss Claudia Mo, your time is up. Members, order, please. Members, quiet. I now put the question to you, and that is that the motion moved by Miss Claudia Mo be passed. Will those in favor please raise their hands? Mr. Gary Fan claims a division. The bell will ring for 1 minute. Please proceed to vote. Please check your votes. If there are no questions, voting is closed and the results are displayed. From FCs, 26 present, 6 for, 20 against, no abstentions. From GCs, 28 present, 13 for, 14 against, no abstention. The question is not agreed by majority respectively of each of the two groups of members present. The motion is negatived. I now adjourn the council and will resume next Wednesday.